One of the reasons why we developed this formula was in order to have something that would work on a closed set, which is a kind of discrete space-time, in which space at a moment of time doesn't make sense. Okay, so that's more or less the introductory survey I wanted to do. Let me just make one last remark, which is that entanglement entropy, one of the many things that lends it intra, I mean, here it's an intra, as it turns out, somewhat surprisingly to me, it's of interest in a whole range of situations for reasons that I tried to indicate. But the very simplest reason why entanglement entropy might be regarded as fascinating is that it's purely quantum in nature. There's nothing, I mean, entropy is, of course, a classical concept that originated in classical statistical mechanics. But so there's nothing specifically quantum about that. But the notion of entanglement entropy is specifically quantum in nature. It's something that cannot happen classically. That is, it cannot happen classically that you can have two composite system which, taken as a whole, has no entropy, and yet its parts, taken just as parts, without reference to the other part, do have entropy. So perhaps in that way, perhaps it also has something to do with the foundations of quantum mechanics or the meaning of quantum mechanics. It's certainly one of the things that distinguishes quantum from classical statistical mechanics. If you go off in that direction, you can start asking yourself conceptual questions like, are we talking, again, I'll just write this here for those to whom it might suggest something. Is entropy in this sense a Gibbs entropy or a Boltzmann entropy? Which is really raising the question of how do we think of a density matrix and ultimately how do we think of a state vector? Because that's a special case of a density matrix in quantum mechanics. Is it more like a point in phase space, more something that's a complete description of the reality at that moment of time, or is it more like a probability distribution, which is what you get in? That's the notion of Gibbs entropy is the entropy of some probability distribution in phase space. But the Boltzmann entropy is the entropy of some given state, some given microscopic state. So, yeah, this distinction might not be familiar to you, so I don't want to say too much more, but just raise that question. So, that's the survey, the introductory survey. Does anyone want to make any comment or question about anything so far? Okay, so let me say now a little bit more about the black hole case, because it throws light on a very fundamental issue that arises in connection with entanglement entropy, which is the issue of continuum versus discrete and the need for a cutoff. So in the case of the black hole, which is regarded as a solution of the classical Einstein equations, one is dealing, of course, with a continuum space-time. And as we'll see, if you compute entanglement entropy across any surface, any spatial surface, it doesn't have to be the horizon or black hole, but if you compute it across any surface, you get an infinite answer. The reason this is in continuum field theory, the reason that you get an infinite answer can be traced to the existence of arbitrarily small modes, of arbitrarily short wavelengths in the neighborhood of this, I'll call it the horizon, but it could be any entangling surface that we consider. So each mode roughly, when we come to talk about the area law, I'll make this more quantitative. But roughly each mode contributes its own, say, one on the order of one bit, let's say, to the entanglement entropy, and there's an infinite number of modes. So So you get an infinite energy. So that, of course, is a useless concept. Besides which, it's wrong. The black hole doesn't have an infinite energy. What it's telling us is that we need a cutoff. But we can't. Not all these putative modes actually can be contributing. The simplest way for them not to contribute is not to be there at all, because there's an underlying discreteness of the space-time. So the finiteness of black hole entropy, I put implies, but it should be taken in a heuristic sense. Of course, it's not a proof of anything, but it's a very strong, to my mind, the strongest argument for an underlying discreteness on the underlying basis of space-time, whatever it is discrete and not continuum, not continuous. And then interestingly enough, not only tells you that there should be a discreteness, but it gives a very strong clue to the scale of the discreteness. Because as I said before in words, the entropy of the black hole, the full entropy, we know, or we have very good arguments, very good reasons. Of course, there's no experimental test of this. I should now make a bow to Urmasi, who told me that I should say what I think, which is that, of course, experiments sometimes get a short shrift. It's in the end experiment that always decides, you know, that you actually aren't really doing physics until you've made contact with experiment, or done the experiment. That's going far. I don't want to say that, because there's a lot of information we get about the world is not from experiment, it's from observation. If you go back to the very beginnings of physics and modern science, you go back to the beginnings of those, it was a mixture of experiment and observation, but you could argue that observation played the greater role, because it's celestial mechanics. People didn't set up little solar systems and tune, you know, find a Feshbach resonance, now that I know what it is, tune the parameters of the solar system. There's only one solar system. It's all observation. It's not experiment, but it's contact with reality. That's the important thing. So when I write that we know the entropy of a black hole, it's by indirect arguments. It's not finally proven, but those indirect arguments are resting on experiments and observations that are so convincing that the whole chain of argument, very few people doubt. So we know that the black hole carries an entropy proportional to its area. And the proportionality constant, there's a number of order of one, objectified. If you want the exact thing, it's 2 pi times the area over, how do I write this? Over kappa, where kappa is the gravitational, the rationalized gravitational coupling constant, 8 pi times Newton's constant. So we know that at least the leading term in the entropy takes this form. And this kappa, I mean, when I wrote this formula, I said C to 1 and H bar to 1. Don't ask me to put them back here, but somehow it's the right combination. I'll get a length squared. That's the Planck length. So this is saying that the entropy is the area in units of the Planck length squared. So if you go to that sort of heuristic picture I gave before of these little modes, the modes should stop existing or stop contributing, and therefore probably stop existing at the scale of L squared, which is telling you that the scale of the discreteness, if there is a fundamental discreteness, is the Planck length. So black hole entropy is giving us quite a lot of information, again at a heuristic level, about the deep structure of space-time. It should have a discreteness, but the discreteness, now I say something which I'm going to ignore for the rest of the lecture, but I wish I didn't have to ignore it. Which is the discreteness should be covariant in nature. In other words, by covariant I mean what you might call Lorentz invariant. One should not have to choose a frame to define this cutoff. Unfortunately, there are no there's only one known way of doing this, which is the causal set, which is a form of discreteness that's compatible with the local Lorentz invariance. So ultimately, we would like to compute the entanglement entropy on the causal set. And some of us are working on that now. That's another old story. But maybe by next year it'll be complete enough that I can talk on this. But although I said that all these arguments were very powerful, and the argument for the area, for this formula, I think, is unassailable, but the interpretation in terms of the discreteness and the cutoff and so on, which I just ran through, that has a weakness because we don't have a way of deriving the cutoff formula, or the entropy, the entanglement entropy with a cutoff, except in a way that picks a frame that violates Lorentz invariance. So as I said, I wish I didn't have to do that, but I will. So I will use the sort of old-fashioned way. In these lectures, we will pick a frame, and we'll define, by a frame, I mean, you know, I mean a frame of reference in a relativistic sense, and we'll define the cutoff in that frame. Of course, if you're doing condensed, if you're thinking of this kind of application, whatever it was, condensed matter here, then it's not an issue because you're dealing with a collection of atoms. Those atoms are roughly at rest in some frame. You know what the cutoff is exactly. You understand that there are no modes shorter than the spacing between atoms and so on. But in the case of the space-time applications, the ones relevant to quantum gravity, there's no such, as far as we believe, no such discreteness depicts of the nature of atoms of space that would have well-defined world lines in time, and therefore they don't pick out a frame. So that's the little apology or sermon, what we really ought to be doing and what I really will be doing for the rest of this lecture, which is essentially the same as almost everyone else does.
So atoms of space-time as opposed to atoms of space.
Yes, the causal set has, exactly, the causal set has atoms of space-time, but not atoms of space.
So just a remark, which might help, which is that just simply remembering that lengths are not invariant in special relativity suffices to tell you that if you want a theory that's Lorentz invariant, then you can't simply have a simple length cut. I mean, just reminding everybody about what we know about length not being an invariant.
That's right. Length is not invariant. Time lapse is not an invariant. But what is invariant is volume, space-time volume. That's a crucial fact about relativity, about the Lorentz group. And that particular fact is one of the basic kinematic facts that lies behind the whole causal set approach. So volume, roughly speaking, volume is invariant because if you go to a moving frame, there's a Lorentz contraction, but there's a time dilation. So the product of the length and the time doesn't change. And then the two transverse moments, the dimensions aren't influenced by the Lorentz transformation. So it's not only area in that particular, with respect to that particular object that's invariant, but it's the full space-time volume. Yeah.
Is special relativity expected to be valid across all these length scales?
So you put it in the passive voice, so the question is expected by whom? So if you ask me, I say yes. What we really know is that there are extremely tight experimental bounds on the violations of Lorentz invariance. But of course they're not infinitely tight. And so there's a whole range of opinion among people working on quantum gravity. And the most extreme, I would say, is what sometimes people call analog gravity. People would like to really go back to Galilean physics or something. Basically, they'd like to take a spin system or some sort of condensed matter system of the sort we understand and choose the content, the particular spins and the particular interactions. They'd like to choose them in just such a way that it'll reproduce an effective curved space-time with the Einstein equations. And that would be their ultimate goal. if they were to succeed, then of course Lorentz invariance would be a pure artifact of low energies, and at high energies you would go back to the Galilean space-time. I always like to tease them and say, well, we'll go back to Aristotelian space-time too. We shouldn't even have the relativity in the Galilean space, right? There should be an absolute rest and so on. Not only an absolute simultaneity. But that's one extreme view. The other view, other extreme, I suppose I'm on the other extreme, where I think that Lorentz invariance it's not just, I think it's much more than just an invariance principle. I think it's the historical root in which we arrived at the notion of space-time metric. The notion of space-time metric is telling us the nature of time, and it's telling us that there is no absolute simultaneity. It's telling us that there's a kind of parallel, as opposed to series, a parallel kind of behavior, kind of relationship between time in one place and time in another place. In other words, I'm just trying to say the causal structure of reality is that of special relativity. It's really defined by light, phones, and so on. And that seems a much more fundamental fact than just Lorentz invariance itself. So to get rid of, if you believe that this is even approximately correct locally, then you really have to have some form of local Lorentz invariance. That's my view. Then there's intermediate views with people. For example, there's what's called Hochschild-Lifshitz gravity, which is an idea that there is actually a fundamental slicing, or that is a fundamental time parameter. So there's a fundamental notion of simultaneity, which shows up at very high energies. It's not like these condensed matter. They're not making it out of little, you know, spins or atoms or something. They're not making a BEC to describe space-time. But they're taking that there is an absolute simultaneity. Sometimes it's called an ether or an Einstein ether. That's other names that it goes by. They're motivated in that case by the better reorganization properties of such theories. So there's no consensus, I would say. People are pursuing a large range of possibilities. But personally, I find it very difficult to believe that we'll go back to the notion of space-time that we had 150 years ago, that that's the way forward towards quantum gravity.
Is there a Lorentz-invariant version of density matrices?
Is there any what?
Lorentz-invariant formulation of density.
Well, that's a good question. To a certain extent, and that's related to the thing that I raised before, I think one would really like a histories-based discussion of the whole concept of entropy. And that's another topic we could go off on. The simplest answer I could give you, aside from, without going off in that direction, is that in a Heisenberg picture, you could say that it was Lorentz invariant, right? Because in a Heisenberg picture, it's the operators that evolve with time, or that vary from one space-time point to another, whereas the state vector doesn't change except during this mysterious measurement process, which I guess we'll hear a whole talk, is it next week, about the issue, the philosophical and conceptual issues that this measurement raises. But aside from doing that measurement, the state vector doesn't change. And if you want to think of a density matrix, as you can, always as an incoherent superposition of different pure states, different state vectors, then the density matrix also would not change. And therefore, it wouldn't have to refer to any particular frame, because you wouldn't have to say, what is it at this time, or something like that.
But can you have a formulation of that without going to help me here or something?
No, I think it has to be quantum field theory. The only, aside from some things that people have sort of played with, that don't generally go anywhere, and I think it's a fair statement that the only relativistic quantum theories we have are quantum field theories. So absolutely. Yeah. So I think it has to be in the context of quantum field theory.
Do you have a K somewhere in there, Boltzmann constant, that
No, there's no K. There's no K. That's the problem. That's a good question. I mean, the question of where is the K is the question of what are the states that we're counting. Right, because the Boltzmann formula is S is K. I think it was originally written as W, but now we write, which I think maybe someone will know if this is right. I think it stands for Wahrscheinlichkeit, which is the German word for probability. So it's really K log P or something like that. But now we, at least, I mean, this formula is not exact in the case of the density matrix. I'll write that formula in a second. But this is the underlying thought that's behind everything. The number of states, the number of microstates that are in play in a particular case. So here's where Boltzmann's constant relates to entropy. We have, in the case of the black hole, we have this relationship. There's no k here. The reason there's no k here is we don't know what is in. We don't really know what are the states or the degrees of freedom that the black hole entropy is counting. If we knew what that is, then we would know how to put in the k also.
So it's a dimension of entropy.
This is the dimension of, oh, I see what you mean. It might be that we should call this, yeah, this is the dimensionless entropy. So there, and that, so I take it back. In that sense, there is a K in this formula. But I don't take back the understanding. Yeah. But we don't know what this entropy is.
And in the static context, you think of the free space area, phase space problem. So,
right.
In the backward context, how do you?
Well, phase space, when you say phase space, that's a classical way of talking. Yeah. So, of course, classically, that results in this undetermined, totally ambiguous additive constant in the entropy. So, classically, it really only makes sense to talk about entropy differences and not an absolute notion of the entropy. But of course, quantum mechanics gives us an absolute measure of phase space volume, which is just h cubed or whatever dimension you're in. And so then you can call it, in some sort of correspondence limit, you can call it phase space volume. But more generally, it's really this dimension, it's really Hilbert space dimension. Maybe I should start talking about, I mean, maybe I should write down the formula for entropy, and then we can come back and see. For those who may not be familiar with the density matrix formalism and the Gibbs-like phenomenon entropy, as it's called, see exactly what's the relation between this and the formula that people write down. So for a purely random density matrix, I'll write it down. Then the formula for the entropy reduces to this for a density matrix that's not completely random, that's more towards a pure state, but that without being pure, it's a more subtle thing. But I think in an intuitive sense, you can interpret it as a kind of phase space volume, but if you don't want to say it as a semi-classical statement, which I think that is, then you can just say it's an effective Hilbert space dimension. So this is what this N you might think of. The number of states, and that is the number of linearly independent states. So that's the dimension of some subspace of the Hilbert space in which the system is in some sense.
Just a moment. So we have half an hour.
Oh, we have half an hour. Okay, so. Well, I certainly won't finish. I hope to set up the calculation and get some way into the main calculation. But before doing that, now I want to just say, what is entanglement entropy? Technically, how do we define it? So this is, for many of you, I think this will just be a review. Write this S sub E for entanglement entropy. What is entanglement entropy? So this is a review. We'll look at it in the simplest case, which is just a bipartite system, as people say. In other words, a composite system that's made of two subsystems. Again, parenthetically, I think I might have just said this before, I'll say it once again. I wish I could answer this purely from a history's point of view. What is entropy, and then in particular, what is entanglement entropy? in other words, from a path integral point of view, there's also some which I know Bal and co-workers have been thinking about in the last couple of years or something. There's also an algebraic way of thinking about entropy, which in fact is an ingredient in that space-time formula that I talked about a couple of years ago that I referred to recently. Again, I mention these only to say that I won't be using them. I'll be using the absolute traditional approach, which is to work with a density, with a Hilbert space, just a Hilbert space, supposed to be a German, or whatever they call it, fraktur H for Hilbert space, and a density matrix as an operator in that Hilbert space. So that's familiar, I think, to everyone. Now, a density matrix is, so this is the Hilbert space. Density matrix, or if you like, density operator.
I mean, Sachin has been especially emphasizing recently that rho is not really an operator on the Hilbert space. It is in the dual. For example, time evolution is different.
Oh, yes, that's true. That's true. But, well,
so it is misleading to say.
Well, except that the Hilbert space is self dual, so. You get the dualization for free.
But time evolution is different for rho and an observable.
Different for rho than for
an observable.
An observable, yes. I don't think I said that rho was an observable. I just said it was an operator in the Hilbert space. Do you disagree with that, Sachin?
You said it's an operator.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So
whatever.
I didn't say it was an observable operator. And I didn't give it a dependence on time.
This is a politician's talk.
No, but I mean, operator is just an operator.
No, rho is
not. Observable has got a certain meaning, right?
It's true that rho is a.
How do you distinguish? Finite dimensions, how do you distinguish an operator from an observable?
Say that again?
In finite dimensions.
Finite dimensions, yes.
How do you distinguish an operator and an observable?
I mean, any operator could be, according to the ideology of non-relativistic quantum mechanics, just as a side comment, I'll say, it breaks down very badly when we come to relativistic quantum field theory. But if we stick with non-relativistic quantum mechanics, then the ideology, which is a little bit different from the practice, but what people will claim is that every operator can be regarded as an observable.
So
this rho will coincide with some particular observable at any moment in time. But as you say, if we work in the Heisenberg picture, then it never evolves, whereas the observable is supposed to evolve. Or if we work in the Schrödinger picture, then the observable doesn't evolve and it evolves. So so they're not conceptually the same thing. But it is an operator, and so every operator. So I could turn around and say, think of that observable which is represented at this moment in time by that operator. But I don't want to say, I don't think I ever said the word observable until you put it into my mouth. So I'll just take it out. The important thing is that for us will be when we choose a basis, which is going to be the position basis, it will be represented by a matrix. That's really what's important. Highly important for the calculation.
Would you make any correspondence between the density matrix and a probability distribution?
Between density matrix and a probability distribution.
Then
yes.
In that sense, it's a probability distribution is an observable object.
Well, so now we're getting into sort of foundational issues. A probability distribution is not observable in the sense that an observable is supposed to be observable. In other words, an observable is supposed to be something that you can ask. It's a question you can ask of the system. So what's the value of this observable? And you can have a single isolated system and you can measure this observable on it. you get an answer. Whereas you can never measure a probability distribution, right? Because the only way you can do that would be to have an innumerable set of copies of the same system in some sense, in the same state. Then you could repeat measurements over and over again, and you could get it. So there's observed.